first had to get to grammar school. And I said to my mother, I said, I want a career, and I want to go to university, but I want to go to grammar school. And my mother, I call her mother, this was a wonderful person, she took me, put her arm around my shoulder and says, son, she said, there's 9 of us in the family. She said, your dad has been victimised out of the colliery for his activities in the union. To go to grammar school, you've got to have a uniform, you've got to have books, and you've got to pay the rail fare. We haven't got enough to feed you, she said, let alone do anything like that. So she said, please take that out of your mind, she said. And so I did. She said, I wanted you to go to work to bring some money in to make life a bit easier at home. And so the only jobs was available for people in those days was the colliery. So I was 13 and a half when they allowed me out of school. I went straight up the colliery. I asked the colliery manager, I said, I want to go to work underground, please, sir. He said, get back to bloody school, he said. You're too little to do any work underground, he said. And of course, I counted up and I walked away. And then next morning, I'm going to get down there because my friends had already been there. They were having some money to go out on a weekend and I wanted the same thing. So I kept asking and asking, and in the end, he got so fed up with me. He said, go and get a lamp, give me a cheque to get a lamp. And down I went. I was bullied in school by the teachers and blah, blah, blah. And I said, I couldn't wait to get out of school. So I went with the miner. The miner looked at me, he said, to the overman, he said, he's too small. He said, really? I could hear him talking. But he said, he's got to start somewhere. So he took me under his wing. He said, I'll take him for a fortnight. So he took me there. Well, we walked into the coalface, 2.5 miles. I was half dead, but so we got the coalface. Then he gave me a pick and a shovel. I'm not joking, I hardly picked the pick up or the shovel. It was heavy. I thought, good gosh. So he said, start digging the coal, he said. So he showed me how to do it. First, I picked like that, and I thought my arms was going to fall off because the pick comes back off the coal. And anyway, he came down and he pulled some coal. We then had to shovel it into the tub, but it was pathetic, absolutely pathetic. Now we worked in a seam about that day, my back was bent, and I was getting it back, and the miner said, listen to you, he said, you're putting more in the bloody floor than you're putting in the tub. Now put it in the tub, because he had to pay my wages on what we put in the tub and which went at the pit. And to cut a long story short, after 4 days he did a stomach full of me. He told him the old man, he said, I can't cope with him. He said, he's costing me money. He said, I'm spending more bloody time. He said, picking coal up off the other side of the drum. He said, I'm cutting coal. So I had to go. So then they put me with another guy called Fred, wonderful man. He was on what they call a mini. We were cutting a new coal face up. So he didn't have to go like a lunatic to fill drums. He had to get the space right. And he showed me, he said, now listen, Ray, you've got to go down now. He said, when you get home, he said, take the shovel and take the pick, he said, and go somewhere and learn how to use it. And eventually I became a very, very proficient young miner and worked with the very, very best. Now, working underground those days was very, very, very hard, I tell you. Not only you had to walk in, but you had to get that coal face. And when you were in that coal face, you had to work like a Trojan. And in those days, you only got paid what coal you put in a drum. Safety came second. And one day, my miner called Fred. As I told you, a fantastic man, he was a friend. I used to call the house, have tea in his house with his family. And one day, we'd been doing some work to move the drum a bit closer to the coal face. It was now 1 hour to finishing time. So I said to Fred, let's put up some props. I said, because I don't like the look of the roof. We haven't got any props there. So he said, Ray, he said, can we, we've got an empty drum. And he said, if we fill it a bit quick, he said, they'll take it away and bring another one up. He said, and while they're bringing another one up, he said, we'll put the props up. But so in the end, I had to give in to Fred. He was the experienced miner. So we went there, we started cutting the coal, and we'd only half filled the tub, and all of a sudden, we heard the roof call, and down it came. The old cool face came down. Now, I pulled myself out of it, I dislocated my shoulder, I cut my shoulder, and I got up and I just looked and I thought, well, where's Fred? I couldn't see Fred. And then all of a sudden I could see two legs just poking under his huge rock, and he was just twitching there. And I screamed on top of my voice, Fred, Fred. And I rushed to there. The rock was too heavy for me to pick up. I got a wedge to try and wedge it up a little bit, thinking that he's still alive. But I was screaming all the time, and eventually some of the other miners from the other faces came rushing up, and we got off. But it was too late, he was dead. He passed away. And the tears were streaming down my eyes. And so the overman said to me, he said, Ray, when you go home, he said, you knew Fred and the family, he said, will you just call in and see the wife? So here I was now, a 14-year-old, with that to do. And I got up on the pit, black as ace of spades, no one was there. The Utah had gone, because every time somebody died or got killed, the Utah would go. And the miners would come up off the face. And so then everybody's out on the doorstep. Whose husband is it? Whose son is it who's been killed? And I walked down the street, and then I came within about 50 yards of Fred's house. And Mrs. Smith was there with a baby in arms, two children. And I walked, and as I was walking towards her, she knew straight away that it was Fred. And I didn't say anything to her. The tears were streaming down my face. That's all we did was hug one another. And I just said, I'm sorry. And I'd done what I could for the family. But that was just one. I could tell you a story of about four or five of dear friends of mine who went under the ground. Now, another story I want to tell you very, very quickly, if I could, before I talk to you about the strike, because the film you're going to see is one of the finest films that have ever been made. And why this film means so much to me was, when I was working in the ground, we had to walk 3 miles into the coal field, and then two-thirds of the way in, there was a little bit of a head in there with some rocks there for us to sit down on, and we had a bit of a break, drop of water, finish there, and we had about 10 minutes, quarter of an hour, where we would want to change the world, make the place a better place to live in, get rid of this bloody Tory government, you know, make things much better. And I couldn't find a place to sit, but bar next is one fella. So I went and sat by him, and I said, hello. So I didn't take much notice, I drank my water, and my miner went off. Off we went together. Don't bloody sit by him, he said. I said, why not? Well, he said he's one of those. I said, what do you mean he's one of those? He said he's one of these bloody ass bandits. I said, what are you talking about? He said he's after you. He said he'd be after you. So I was a bit flummoxed by what he said. But the next day, I went in, and I thought, he's on his own. I thought, so I went and sat by him purposely. And eventually we had a little talk, we were talking, and he was just a lovely person. And after about 3 or 4 months, he said to me, he said, I said, why is everybody avoiding you? He said, well, because I'm different from you, Ray. He was about 25, lovely, strong man, muscular. I said, well, how are you different? Well, Ray, he said, if you see a young girl sauntering down the street, he said, shaking her lips, he said, it probably stirs up down your below. I said, well, yes, I said, that's pretty normal. But he said, for me, he said, that happens when a man do it. Now, Ray, he said, I know you don't go touching girls' bums and things like that. And he said, I don't. He said, because we're two civilized people, we don't do things like that. But he said, that's it. He said, but it's a different, it's a hard world, Ray. I said, well, we go to Cardiff. I said, don't in Cardiff, because I'm up in the valleys where former is right. And he said, I've gone down there. He said, but the police seem to recognise me straight away. They take me and they give me such a beating, Ray. He said, so I don't go there anymore. So he said, I'm just living in a prison. So I tried to bring it up in the lodge with the National Union Federation of Miners. No, they didn't want anything to do with it. We got to struggle to earn our money and to get better conditions. He said, that's sideline. I tried every way I could to do it. I went to see the MP, and we'd done everything. And then eventually I was inbleeded at recovery when I was about 19, and I was conscripted into the army. While I was in the army and I was overseas, I was up on the border during the Cold War, and the letter came for me. I opened it, my father gave me all the local gossip. Oh, he said, by the way, I got bad news for you, he said, you and Fred and him, he said, was found floating upside down in the quarry pond. He couldn't take it anymore. He'd been persecuted by everybody around him, and he just couldn't take any more. And from that day on, I tell you, I became an avid campaigner against homophobia. When I joined the Labour Party, I went to a Labour Party conference. I went to see two MPs who I knew they were sympathetic. We agreed to put a fringe meeting up, and we had a fringe meeting, and three people turned up. And the MP said, oh, well, we leave it out. No, I said, we bloody won't leave it. If it's only three people, we will do the meeting, I said, and we will make a report, and we will circulate to every member of bloody parliament to know about the injustice that's been going on against a section of our community. So the meeting went ahead, and we got the report out, and the next year, we had 20 at the meeting. And the year after that, we had 50 at the meeting. And today, I tell you, the gay rights fringe meeting in our Labour Party conference is the biggest fringe meeting there is, because right now we've made such big strides. And during the miners' strike, there was still quite a bit of homophobia amongst the miners, and so I was trying to get them to get some of the gay people down who'd been on to me and asking me what they can do and they can raise money. But even then, they didn't want much to bother to do with it. But eventually they did. They did start sending money down. And in the end, the miners, the ones who were with me on the support group, they came and they realised, you know, what decent people they were, that they went out to this campaigning. And when we went to a trade union conference, there was a gay rights meeting, the fringe meeting at the conference. And I said to the men, come on, we could go here now. I said, all right, great. So we went there. And they had gay rights badges and things like that, and they were quite taken, and the miners themselves got up and made a contribution, so you know, much they did. And then when we came out the next day, they were going into the conference, I had these badges from, I said, where's your badges? Oh, we left them there, right? No, I said, I got a few extra ones here. So on these miners, I pinned all the badges, so they went into there, amongst all the other miners' delegation, with their badges, and everybody sort of accepted it and this, that, and the other. So pride is something about that, you know what I mean? But even much better. Now, the miners strike. Now, the miners are the salt of the earth, and I'm very, very proud to have been a miner and to work there and to struggle with them for better conditions, etc. And All what we got today, wasn't handed down from the government. I'll tell you that now sincerely. Even though you pay for your university, it at least you got access to it. And when I was working underground, listening to the miners, I could hear the talk going on. Well, for me, I listened to everything the old communists were saying and some of the Labour people were saying, etc. And I was interested in hospitals. And why was I interested in hospitals? I tell you why I was interested in hospitals. We were one of nine. That fantastic man of mine, who I loved a bit, and wanted me to go to work so I could bring some money home. One day, I came home from school, and my cousin met me coming down, and he said, Ray, he said, your mum is dead. I said, what are you talking? Don't talk stupid, I said. I said, my mum is having a baby, and I said, she's had the baby, and she started going to hospital. I said, just to make sure things are all right. I said, no, Ray, he said, she's dead. And I just couldn't believe it, so I rushed home, And when I got home there, there was everybody in the village was there working. And eventually my brothers and sisters was whisked off to an orphanage, and I was going to be farmed off to my auntie. Family had gone. But before that, when I went in that house and I realised my mum had gone, I rushed up those stairs. I looked for something that I could take to my mum, and I got her bonnet, which she used to take us to the cinema with, and I rushed to the top of the mountain. And I said, God, if you are a true God, and I was very religious at the time, I said, please give us our mum back. I said, we had a lovely family. I said, please give us our mum back. And I walked on that mountain thinking, that when I go back home, she'd be there. But she wasn't there. And I'm afraid I parted company with my religion from that day. But what made it worse, what set the fire burning in my belly, was the next day, my father was broken-hearted in the house. The doctor came along. George, he said, a tragedy of it all. He said, Winnie died from an hospital bed and a pint of blood or an abortion. That's what she died for. And I realised then that something was wrong with this world of ours. And when I was working underground, and I heard the people talking about we've got to build a new world after this war was over, because this was during the war. And so they were saying we've got to build an health service. He says we've got to build hospitals. We've got to give our kids schools. He said we've got enough of the 30s and the bloody 20s. He said when the bloody rich are scooping it all up together. He said and we're down here. He said treated like muck. And he said, like the rest of the working class, he said, we're going to change the world. But I said, we can do that. Well, he said, we've got to be campaigning all the time. He said, there's an election coming up. He said, in 3 months' time. So I said, shall I join the Labour Party? Labour Party? Bloody wishy, bloody washy, he said. You can join the Young Communist League, he said, if you want to do some bloody thing. So I went and joined the Young Communist League. And my father was well up in the Labour Party then, he was, and he was quite left. He said, Sonny, I heard you joined the Young Communist League. Yes, I said. Well, he said, we're in the Labour Party. He said, we want to change the world as well. No? I know, Dad, he said. I said, but you had a bit of wishy-washy. I said, I'm going to stay with the Young Communist League. And so out I went with the Young Communist League, comes in, all the meetings, called a strike, a boy strike, because of poor conditions. And done loads of things in that direction. And one day, when that election was held, we were walking out of the pit, and we got to pit bottom, and of course we were waiting for our turn to go up in the cage. There must have been about 50 miners waiting. And every now and again the phone used to go, Labour have taken Cheltenham, or Labour have taken Bradford. And then all of a sudden they said, Labour got an overall majority. And I looked at some of the members, and they were hard. God, yeah, they were hard. And tears were streaking down some of the down their cheeks. You could see it where they was washing into cold or something. I said, Fred, what are you crying for? I said, what am I crying for, you dumb bugger? He said, your mum, he said, we can't do nothing but your mum. He said, but we'll do something for all the other moms. He said, we will build hospitals. He said, they won't have to want for pints of blood in future. He said, we'll have that, he said. And we will take control of the commanding lights of the economy, he said. We will make sure that the money comes down into the bottom. He said, we'll have good education. And he said, we'll take over the banks, we'll take over everything. And it was like a utopia. And the Labour Party in those days themselves was pretty much to the left. But it was the miners who were the driving force in the Labour Party who were putting down what we needed to do. And then we did take over the commanding rights of the economies, except the banks, and we did nationalise the gas and the electric. We set up an aircraft industry. We set up British European Airways and British Airways. We set up all those things. But more than that, Nylan Bevan, who was a fantastic bloody miner, he never went to bloody grammar school either, but he put on this statute for the health service. And what a wonderful health service, which is now under threat at the present moment, by this horrible government that we've got in Westminster. Now, a lot of people don't realise that how strong and committed the Miners were. What they had was that they didn't have one Miner, one vote in that sense. In their constitution, they had blocks. You had the South Wales Miners, you had the North East Miners, the West Miners. And it was they who made the decision, and the Miners. But it was always voted in these meetings, etc. And in 1972, the Miners came out on strike for better conditions. They wanted infusion water into coal, peaked on the desk. They wanted more mechanical props, which was there, and they wanted safety taken out of the hands of the miner themselves. You just had to get the coal, etc. And so we had the strike started. My dad obviously was involved in the strike. We went all over the country there, and we brought the country to a standstill. We did. And Ted Heath, who was the member of the Prime Minister at that time, he said, he called the election on the basis, who rules the country? Who rules the country? And when the vote took place, he was kicked out of office because the people knew the injustices that was taking place, and it showed that it was the miners. It was there. And so it was people power. None, doesn't matter what elections, no matter who got into power, if there were injustices there, the power lay with the people. And in those days, a lot of power lied with the miners. And so the miners had the strength enough to bring down a Tory government of that day. And in a democracy, what we've got today, that's so important. And for me, the lesson we've had of that miners' strike in 1972 have stayed with me for the rest of my life. When I'm campaigning against bombs, against nuclear weapons, against the wars in the Middle East, and against homophobia, against all these other things. It's always there. There's never a wasted campaign ever. And then coming up to the current strike, when that took place, immediately I helped set up a miners support group. And I was on the council at that time, but I've said to everybody, council work comes very much a last thing for me. I'm out there. We collected money. We went with singing on the streets to raise money on the streets of Cardiff and Caerphilly. Every night we went out collecting money, collecting food from the various houses. We made sure that everybody had a parcel. Every miner was on strike had a parcel at the end of the week. Sometimes it was a big parcel, sometimes it wasn't very, very big. And the miners were an inspiration to the rest of the world. The money and things were coming in everywhere. And I can remember one occasion, there was two black men came to one of our big meetings, and after I spoke off the platform, I came to him. He came up to me and he said, he wanted to talk. So I said, well, you don't know what I said. He said, well, he said, we're in the miners' union, he said, in South Africa. And I said, you've got big problems in South Africa. Yes, he said, Ray. He said, we've got big problems, but you are our inspiration. We will go from here, he says, from this meeting, and we will go back to South Africa. And not only will we fight for better conditions for miners, we will fight for our freedom against the yoke of the right-wing, vicious, fascist South African government, Ray. And the miners, that miners' strike, people said it was a defeat at the end. It was never a defeat. The miners' strike was never, ever a defeat. Whatever campaign any of you are involved in, whether it's students' rights, or whether you go out into the community and you feel you've got to campaign for something or other, you may not win that there. But every time you involve yourself in a campaign, you're striking a nail in the coffin of those injustices which have plagued your own personal life. So don't ever believe that the miners' strike was a defeat. Yes, there was a betrayal. There was a betrayal. It was betrayed by Neil Kinnock, who was the leader of the Labour Party, who knew, living in the mine community, of the constitution about the miners, etc., and he kept on calling for national ballot. Give us a ballot, give us a ballot, he said. He wouldn't do anything about it. And the other one was Kim Howells. He never worked underground, but he was funded by the NUM to go to university because they wanted a full-time official to be to university. But believe you me, between him and Kinnock and a few others, they were the ones that betrayed the strike at the very, very end. And due to that strike, I lost my freedom on one or two occasions, the same as an awful lot of miners. We went, one aspect of it was the day-to-day thing, the bread and butter things collected food is happening there. But when there were demonstrations and marches, we would be there. And we said, we've got to go to Aubrey, whether we could ship them, wanted to ship cola. And so the call was Aubrey, get to Aubrey. And so up we went to Aubrey. Now, I want you to sort of visualise local colliers in South Wales that we were picking on a regular basis. We tried to get there, we were always prevented by the police. Oh, can't go there today. Why can't we go there? So we had to park our car about a mile and a half away and go along a different route to get down there. But we always got down there in the end. But when we went up to Aubrey, I thought, oh, we'll have to park about 5, 10 miles away to get into Aubrey. But instead of that, the miners were saying, the police were saying, oh yes, Aubrey, I think there's a demonstration, said, go for another 3 miles, turn right on this road, blah, blah, blah. They were so bloody lovely. It's just unbelievable that those police could be so fantastically helpful. Didn't take much note of it, but when we went into Aubrey and saw, we were there, fortunately for me, and for some others, I wasn't. There was no room for me in the main place where it was all happening. And the priest had something there. But by this time, the miners had broke through the cordon, and they were marching down there. And I tell you this: I've seen violence. I've been in a coal hall. I've seen death close up. I've seen death close up under the ground. But the way those police, those mounted police, beat our boys and girls there. You know, it has stuck with me for the rest of my life. They were absolutely vicious. Blood flowed everywhere. And the arrest was made at Sky Hill, who was a great leader, a great inspiration, despite what anybody says. Arthur Scargill didn't let miners down. Arthur Scargill was better than any other trade union leader. He was out in front. He was arrested about 4 or 5 times at the workers' freedom. Because he always said, that it's not about money, it's not about anything else. What this strike is about is saving our community. And he said, if we didn't save our communities, he said, we would have massive unemployment. He said, they've got nothing to put in its place. And so the driving force behind that strike was not money, it was about saving our communities. That's all it was about. And the lies that came out from Thatcher and the lies that came out from the NCP at that point in time, they said, it's only about 3 pits in Wales will go, and there's only a few thousand miners would be made redundant, etc. But don't listen to Arthur Scargill and his lies and blah, 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 blah. And when the strike ended on that Monday, and it was only lost by about 2 votes, and the strike was called off, they came there with a vengeance, and all our pits within the 12 men was practically closed. And up in our valleys, up in Caerphilly, up in the Rhondda, up in the western valleys, in the valleys of those coal fields in South Wales, there's about 53 youth unemployment. Our kids, many of them on drugs, many of them find their way into prison and stuff like that. Never ever did those Tories, did that Margaret Thatcher put anything there for our kids, you see. And so, yeah, yes. Proud to be a magnet, proud to play the part in that strike, and the inspiration of the miners throughout their history would be an inspiration for the rest of the world and for anybody who's seeking justice. But please look at that film, because that film will show you how other brave people were so determined to help the miners. So thank you for listening. I have brought a few books there. I've only got 10, unfortunately. It's about a miner's life. It's about the strike. It's about the thing in much more detail than what I've been talking about. And those 10 are there for sale at £6. And I know that my good friend Deb has written a book as well of individual miners' own take on the miners' strike. So there's two books there which will be for sale if you want to buy them. So thank you very much for listening, and please enjoy this film like I will for the second time. Thank you.
Right, we're going to watch the film. When the film's finished, we're going to have a Q&A. We've got a couple of other guests coming who were involved in the NUM at the time of the strike. Rob Stokes, is it?
Yeah,
Brenton, yes, that's it. Yeah. They'll be coming along after the film, but I think we should watch the film now. So.